Okay, we go on to the next case on our docket related in subject matter, which is California Chamber of Commerce as appellee versus Rob Bonta as appellant intervener. And the appellant, here's Mr. Metzger in the appellee counsel is Mr. Norris. I think I got that right. So proceed with the appellant's argument, please.
Thank you very much, Your Honors. My name is Raphael Metzger. I represent the appellant, the Council for Education and Research on Toxics. Pursuant to Alexander versus United States and other Supreme Court precedents, a preliminary injunction may not issue to enjoin the exercise of First Amendment rights because such a preliminary injunction would itself constitute an unconstitutional prior restraint on the exercise of First Amendment rights. As a matter of law, the district judge therefore erred in issuing the preliminary injunction in this case, enjoining CERT and other NGOs from filing Proposition 65 lawsuits in state court.
And so, like with the previous case, you know, you are free to structure your argument however you like. I want to tell you that my primary concern is that your client doesn't have standing to pursue this appeal. And I want to make sure I let you know that so that you have time to appropriately address that issue, but you are free, of course, to structure your argument as you wish.
All right. Well, then let me get to that right away, Your Honor. So my client has been enjoined from filing lawsuits. It was enjoined by the district court judge. My client is a party to the case. It intervened in the case as an intervener defendant. To hold that my client cannot appeal when it has been enjoined by the district court, I think would violate due process.
Yeah, to appeal the preliminary injunction, right? We're at preliminary injunctive stage. So a case which you didn't address in your opening brief, and despite the fact that that the opposing party cited it, you didn't address it in your reply brief, is the Virginia House of Delegates case, where the court said, and I quote, "As the court has repeatedly recognized, to appeal a decision that the primary party does not challenge, an intervener must independently demonstrate standing." And the court previously listed the three specific elements: a concrete and particularized injury that is fairly traceable to the challenged conduct and that is likely to be redressed by a favorable decision. Where in the record is there anything that suggests that your client, while the preliminary injunction is pending, is even thinking about going forward with another action that would be actually enjoined?
Okay. So my client has in fact just recently filed a major action regarding acrylamide under Prop 65. That is currently in litigation.
Is that something other than the Starbucks case?
Yes. The Starbucks case is continuing. It's coming up for
are you referencing just now something different from the Starbucks case?
Absolutely. I'm referencing a case, if I might, a case against manufacturers of these new cooking devices called air fryers, which generate huge amounts of acrylamide.
And is this in the record somewhere?
I believe it is. Cal Chamber filed a motion to dismiss for lack of standing, which was addressed by the motions panel. And we provided the evidence regarding actual harm to my client in opposition to that. That's all in the record in this court. And I would also point out—
Because in your brief, I see CERT has not filed any new Prop 65 cases regarding acrylamide in food in the last 10 years. So this new case is since you filed the blue brief on May 20th and the gray brief on August 11th?
Yes, that's correct. Yes. CERT has been litigating these cases constantly for the last 20 years. And it has not filed many cases. There's only a few cases that it's filed because it's only filed what I call the high impact cases,
well,
namely
but wait,
those.
Can I back up? Let's see, I'm trying to square your statements because what Judge Bennett just read was that you haven't filed any cases in the last 10 years, I thought. And then you said you've been involved in these cases. I assume what you mean when you say you've been involved in these cases is you've sent out a lot of notices.
No, actually, well, CERT has actually litigated only a few cases, but it has been constantly litigating them since 2002. It filed the first one. It's been constantly litigating them since then for 20 years. And it only it's very selective in the cases that it brings. It targets the major sources of acrylamide in the diet. So the very first case was for French fries. And then CERT co-counseled the potato chip case with the California Attorney General. That was more than a decade ago. And then the largest source of acrylamide in the human diet, which is coffee, which is consumed by 2/3 of adults and is the largest source of acrylamide. CERT started that case in 2010 has been litigating it vigorously ever since, including 2 3-month trials at which CERT prevailed. And we were headed towards the remedies phase of trial when the state adopted, under political pressure, adopted a regulation exempting coffee. And that is now on appeal. So CERT has been litigating these issues constantly for the last 20 years. It's been the primary enforcer regarding acrylamide in the human diet. And it has now recently, now that it finally, once it finally briefed everything for the appeal in the CERT versus Starbucks case, it then filed this case against air fryers, which generate huge amounts of acrylamide because they operate at extremely high temperatures. So CERT—
The case that you filed against air fryers would have been barred by the injunction, but for the stay?
That's, we contend not, but the defense is
contending. Explain to me why not. And I apologize, I haven't focused on this. So explain to me why it wouldn't have been barred by the injunction absent the motions panel ruling.
Yes. I think it would technically not have been barred because it is not against the food industry. It's against a machine. And I think the scope of the
this lawsuit that you have recently filed wouldn't have been barred by the injunction the district court issued?
That's my contention. I believe the defense contends otherwise.
Okay.
All right. But I would point out regarding the issue that you raised regarding standing, the motions panel specifically ruled that it denied the defense I'm sorry, it denied the motion to dismiss for lack of standing without prejudice to Mr. Norris or Cal Chamber raising arguments in their opposition brief. But they made it clear that the only arguments that they could raise are those that are in their opposition brief. And that's very limited. That's only
I don't see how it's very limited. I mean, at page 31 of the brief, they cite Virginia House of Delegates and say you don't meet it, and you chose in your reply brief not to even cite Virginia House of Delegates. And your argument was, as I understand it in your reply brief, that because you were enjoined, you had standing, and that was basically the entirety of your argument. And that's not the way I read the Virginia House of Delegates case.
Well, I appreciate that, Your Honor. And in our opposition to the motion to dismiss, I fully briefed the Virginia House of Delegates case and explained why it's distinguishable. And that's, I'm looking at our opposition to the motion to dismiss. That's at page 9 and page 10. So we have addressed
Is there a reason you didn't put it in your reply brief?
Well, yes. Getting the reply brief down to the size with all these arguments was a challenge. And I thought that's candidly, since the motions panel had denied it, and since we'd addressed it all, and those arguments would be before this court, I thought that I gave it this argument the merit that it deserved. But I perhaps was mistaken, and I apologize for that. But we do address clearly in the opposition to the motion to dismiss why cert has standing. And I would ask the court to consider.
That was before the district court, though, right?
No, that's in this court. In this court,
the motion to dismiss in the Ninth Circuit.
Filed a motion to dismiss our appeal, and the motions panel denied that.
Yeah.
Without prejudice to them asserting arguments in their opposition brief. So I believe that, you know, we fully addressed that, and I could summarize that for the court, but it's all there. And I pointed out that cert actually does has sustained harm. And the particular harm is that cert is a very unique organization in that all of the funds that it receives by virtue of charitable contributions, Cypre distributions, and from Prop 65 lawsuits, every bit of it, CERT then issues as education and research grants to faculty and students, mostly in the UC system, regarding toxic substances. And CERT's ability to continue the funding of those research and education grants has been would be substantially impaired. But that's all in our opposition to the motion to dismiss. It's all there, Your Honors. And I apologize, I could not get everything into the brief in this case due to the page limitations and the substantial arguments. But if I might, to resume with my argument, I believe the motions panel was correct in concluding that the preliminary injunction could not issue because it would be an unconstitutional prior restraint on the exercise of First Amendment rights, according to the United States Supreme Court. But assuming that the court could lawfully issue the preliminary injunction, I believe it erred in doing so for two reasons, and those are comity and abuse of discretion. This case is most unusual because my client had already, I tried the First Amendment issue in Los Angeles Superior Court in the first phase trial of the Cert versus Starbucks case, a 3-month trial. And in that trial, I called on CERT's behalf esteemed retired heads of the federal public health agencies to testify on CERT's behalf. And they testified. These were toxicologists, risk assessment experts, experts in food science. And we litigated that case and we tried it for 3 months. And at the end of it, the judge issued a statement of decision finding that that the First Amendment defense had not been that the First Amendment false compelled speech defense lacked merit, and judging that affirmative defense in favor of my client, sir. So when the district judge in this case had this issue before her, I believe that she should have acknowledged that this issue had already been tried for 3 months with the best scientists in the world, and that we had prevailed, and that she should have accorded some comity to that state court judge's decision. But even if she wasn't going to accord comity to it, at the very least, in considering whether Cal Chamber was likely to prevail on the merits, she should have considered the evidence from the trial of that case from all these esteemed retired heads of federal agencies. And we included that all in the record, and we asked her to consider it. And she said, I don't know that I need to consider any of that. I don't want to delve into the science. And that's an abuse of discretion. That's there's a case specifically on that point, Turner versus Heckler, which says that a district court abuses its discretion in granting a preliminary injunction when the district court fails to consider critical evidence submitted by the party opposing issuance of the preliminary injunction. I believe that principle is especially applicable here, where the district court judge stated at the hearing, quote, I don't want to go off on a review of scientific evidence here. I don't know that there's a point in drawing my attention to specific aspects of the scientific evidence.
Counsel, I wanted to switch back to one question before we start getting into your rebuttal time. When you intervened before the district court, was that a permissive intervention or was that intervention as of right?
It was permissive. What the context was, when my client found out about this lawsuit filed by Cal Chamber, we perceived it to be a collateral attack on the decision of the state court judge, because it sought to enjoin all state lawsuits regarding Prop 65. So we immediately intervened, and that and Cal Chamber and the Attorney General stipulated to our intervention, and the judge, pursuant to that stipulation, executed an order allowing my client to intervene as a defendant.
But it sounds like the district court did not decide whether that was permissive or as of right. It just allowed you to intervene generally.
It was pursuant to stipulation of the parties.
Okay.
Yes. So the last argument that I'll make, and I'll make this very brief because I see I have 2 minutes and 15 seconds, and that is in the recent decision of the United States Supreme Court in Whole Woman's Health versus Jackson, that's the current abortion decision, just last month, the court wrote, quote, the equitable powers of federal courts are limited by historical practice. Consistent with historical practice, a federal court exercising its equitable authority may enjoin named defendants from taking specified unlawful actions. But under traditional equitable principles, no court may, quote, lawfully enjoin the world at large. And this was in the context where the Supreme Court was saying, you can enjoin these Texas Attorney General of the Mississippi, one of those states, sorry, Attorney General from pursuing, from filing a case, but you cannot enjoin derivatively private citizens. And that's exactly what Judge Mueller did here. She
even if you had standing to make your own argument here on appeal, do you have standing to make this argument on behalf of the world at large?
Well, I guess I really don't know, Your Honor. I specialize in toxic tort litigation and toxic substances. I don't profess to be the world's expert on standing, but what I can say is that the private enforcers, some tried to intervene in this case, and Judge Mueller refused to allow them to intervene. So then to enjoin them, you have to refuse without letting them be heard, I think presents due process problems. And I'm just troubled very much with that. The injunction, see, Cal Chamber filed this case, in my view, as a friendly case with the Attorney General, who really views Prop 65 in food as a headache that they wish would go away, seeking to enjoin the Attorney General from filing cases that it's not filing, and derivatively to enjoin the private enforcers from filing the cases that they have been filing without having them be parties. I think that's a fundamental problem with this case. And I think the US Supreme Court's recent decision in Whole Woman's Health bears on that, that courts should be very reluctant to enjoin persons from engaging in constitutionally protected activity when they're not before the court. CERT had to get before the court of its own accord, and the other private enforcers were denied that opportunity. I'll reserve my remaining time. Thank you.
Hey, counsel, all your time was used up. The clock right now shows a figure of the extent to which you went past your time, about a minute. But I'm going to give you rebuttal time because it's an important case and certainly a difficult one. How much time did you plan to make a rebuttal argument?
A few minutes would be excellent, Your Honor. I appreciate it.
Okay, could the clerk put 2 minutes on the clock for Mr. Metzger's rebuttal argument. And we'll turn to Mr. Norris.
Thank you, Judge Gould. Good morning. I'm Trent Norris of Arnold & Porter, representing Appalachia California Chamber of Commerce. May it please the court. The case here is on appeal from a grant of preliminary injunction. And as a result, the question before the court is whether the district court abused its discretion in enjoining prospective private attorneys general from enforcing Prop 65 as to acrylamide in food in the same way that it enjoined the elected attorney general and other elected officials from doing so. Now, CERT is the only appellant here, and as Judge Bennett has noticed, that raises a significant question as to whether CERT has standing. I can come back to that issue in greater detail, but I want to point out a couple of things on standing as well. The first of them is that CERT has no pending notice on acrylamide in food. They have not served a 60-day notice, which is a precursor to filing a litigation. And as
what about the air fryer case?
That case has been filed already, Your Honor. And so
before the injunction?
It was filed in the period when the injunction was stayed by the motions panel's emergency stay order. So it was recently filed, the air fryer case. And as a result, it would not be barred by the injunction.
But your position, it was not barred only because the injunction was stayed. Otherwise, you think it would have fallen within the injunction.
There is a question as to whether it would have been barred because the injunction covers cases concerning acrylamide in food. The CERT lawsuit on air fryers alleges that the manufacturers of air fryers, small tabletop devices that cook food, need to put a warning on those devices, warning consumers that at some times when they use them, they may create acrylamide in the food that they cook. And there would be a question as to whether That is—
Well, the injunction says as applied to acrylamide in food and beverage products. So the question seems to be whether air fryers are food and beverage products. Is that, I mean, is that the right way to frame it up?
That would be one way, Your Honor. I think the defendants in that case might argue that it's subsumed within it, but regardless of that, the case has already been filed. And given that Judge Mueller's ruling only—
Well, but it seems to me that that's not really the right response for standing. I mean, I came into this thinking that they had no desire or no intent to file any future lawsuits after the injunction. If they have filed a lawsuit after the injunction, it does— let's assume that it is a case that falls within the injunction. Why wouldn't that be enough to show imminent harm for purposes of standing?
They would need a notice, Your Honor, that's pending currently. The court's order from the district court applies to those who are private enforcers under a subsection of Prop 65 that indicates you must file a 60-day notice before you file the lawsuit. And it's a finite group. There's only a dozen entities in that category, represented by 9 different law firms, who have pending notices right now. There's hundreds of them.
I'm missing something. Did, for the Fryer lawsuit, did they file a 60-day notice?
They did, Your Honor. They had to in order to—
So as I understand it, that if the injunction would have barred it, and if they were in fact intending to file that lawsuit at the time they filed their notice of appeal, and if that evidence were properly before us, wouldn't that have given them standing at the time they filed their notice of appeal? Isn't that the time we look at?
That would be the time to look at, Your Honor. We contend it does not give them the right to appeal here. And that relates to the right that they're asserting. The right that they're asserting is a right on behalf of the public. And we've asked the court to take notice of the TransUnion versus Ramirez decision of the US Supreme Court on this issue. And it's all briefed fully in our motion to dismiss on the basis of standing.
Well, but don't we look at what the Supreme Court identified in the House of Delegates case? And if at the time they filed their notice of appeal, and the record would seem at least to plausibly indicate this, that at that time they intended to file this lawsuit, they must have done the 60-day notice shortly after the stay was issued, et cetera, that seems to me to easily demonstrate that at the time they filed the notice of appeal, with, if we looked at those facts, that they did have standing. And the fact that at this point they haven't put in anything saying they want to file another one doesn't seem to me to be germane to whether they had standing at the time they filed the original.
I understand, Your Honor, but I think you're focused on whether even having the notice would provide them with standing. And we contend that it does not, because the right that CERT is asking to be able to sue over is a right on behalf of the public. It's the same right that the Attorney General and other elected officials have the power to enforce normally when they're not enjoined by the district court. And that right does not provide, is not based on a concrete harm to CERT or any individualized harm to CERT or any imminent harm to CERT. It's not particular to CERT. They are asserting rights on behalf of the public.
Those arguments seem to collapse, because if CERT is filing on behalf of the public, then then the public is harmed and they're able to defend the public's right. I mean, I don't understand. To me, if CERT falls within the injunction and they had an intent to file a lawsuit, this is a new circumstance I hadn't considered, but I don't understand your position that just because they represent the public, that they're therefore not covered. I mean, the injunction covers private enforcers, so CERT would therefore be covered by it.
Yes, CERT would be covered by the injunction, but CERT would not have standing to challenge it at this point. And the reason is,
Your Honor, could somebody who is bound by the injunction not have standing? I explain that to me.
Because they wouldn't have had standing to sue in federal district court in the first instance, because they're not asserting a right that's particularized, concrete, imminent under Lujan.
But counsel, I admit I'm missing the same thing that Judge Nelson says he's missing here, that the injunction would have barred them if it had been in effect, or at least arguably would have barred them from filing the very lawsuit that they have now filed.
Arguably, yes, Your Honor.
And even if we were to find that they didn't have the authority to vindicate the universe at large, wouldn't they at least have standing to raise on appeal that the injunction, to the extent it barred them, and I think many of the issues would be the same, that that it was an abuse of the discretion for the district court to enter it? Why wouldn't they at least have standing to raise, well, it would have stopped us, and to the extent it would have stopped us, the district court abused its discretion?
Because what it's stopping them from doing, Your Honor, is asserting a right on behalf of the public, which the Attorney General is not even entitled to assert. See, what CERT would like here from a reversal is an absurd result, which is that the Attorney General and 62 other elected officials cannot sue to enforce Prop 65 on acrylamide in food, but CERT can, and private enforcers can. And that does violence to the very structure of Prop 65.
Well, no, it doesn't do violence to it, because they chose not to appeal. I mean, if two parties are parties to the case and one appeals and one doesn't, I don't think it's harmful to give the party that appeals relief if they're entitled to it.
Well, then maybe we should go on to whether they're entitled to that relief, because I think the standard of review here is abuse of discretion. CERT has claims, for instance, that the right to petition is absolute, that it has a right to petition, in fact, that it cannot be infringed, and that to do so here would be a prior restraint, notwithstanding the lack of any case law applying the prior restraint doctrine to the filing of lawsuits. The district court balanced the harms here. First, the district court, in applying the Winter factors, found that Cal Chamber has a likelihood of success on the merits, that indeed the members of Cal Chamber have their First Amendment rights infringed by Prop 65 lawsuits here, because they force a false, or very least misleading, and certainly controversial warning to be placed on their food products. Second, that there was irreparable harm to the Cal Chamber's members. Having found that, the court then went on to balance the harms and to look at the public interest. And the court understood that there was a burden here on CERT and other private enforcers in not being able to file their own lawsuits enforcing Prop 65. But the court felt that that was outweighed by the harm to Cal Chamber and its members from the type of litigation, hundreds of cases we're talking about, that have been filed against the food industry on this, which are very difficult to defend and which result in settlements 99% of the time, that either put a warning on a package, which is contrary to what the food company and its position is, so it infringes on their right to free speech and to not speak, and to speak clearly and honestly. But then it also requires either that or payment of substantial penalties, up to $2,500 per cup of coffee, per box of cereal, per jar of olives, or bottle or jar of almonds, for instance. And that was difficult to contest in state court. The court had every right to balance those authorities and then to exercise its general equitable powers to enjoin private enforcers using the wording that's prescribed by Rule 65 of the Federal Rules of Civil Procedure. You know,
I appreciate this analysis. It's helpful in your argument. How much of the district court's order is covered by a legal standard versus factual findings? Because it seems like a lot of this is ultimately factual findings, but some of it hinges on on the appropriate legal standard. Could you address the difference there, how you see that?
So, Your Honor, the underlying legal standard is Zoderer and compelled false speech. There's a gloss on it from the NIFLA decision as well. And what Cal Chamber had to show was that the warning is controversial. I'm sorry, what the Attorney General had to prove and what CERT standing as an intervener defendant had to prove was that the warning was purely factual, non-controversial.
So would that be a factual finding when the district court makes that, or is it a mixed question of fact and law?
I think that is the standard, and there's been no contest about the legal standard. So the question is the warning controversial? Is the warning purely factual? And the district court—
That's a factual finding by the court as it applies that, okay.
Yes, Your Honor. And then
the second one is it justified and not unduly burdensome? Is your position that that would also be a factual finding from the district court?
It would be, Your Honor. That was not a point of contention or a discussion.
Okay. Reasonably related to a substantial government interest. Was that addressed below?
That was also not addressed.
Okay. Below. So really all we're dealing with is this first factor.
That's correct. And so when CERT argues, well, the district court didn't credit our evidence, well, CERT's evidence, just like the Attorney General evidence, is we think acrylamide causes cancer in humans. The evidence on the other side of that is there's a lot of evidence that shows it does not cause cancer in humans. And in fact, we point out there is no evidence precisely that it does cause cancer in humans. And
so the counsel, if we were going to address the merits here, does the Attorney General's amicus brief telling us, at least as to when the Attorney General filed it, what is going on here with Safe Harbor, et cetera. Does that make any difference here in your client's view?
No, Your Honor, we don't think so, because the proposed warning, it's not been finalized yet, which would be one of many wordings that could be used, but one that would be deemed to be valid by the state if it's indeed adopted. Is one that we think would also be misleading for lots of reasons, and we haven't litigated that issue yet. But it may state that it's a probable human carcinogen, but you have to think about how do consumers understand this warning? What is it actually communicating to consumers?
And as far as you know, and I know this isn't in the record, but as far as you know, is that still proceeding to some sort of finality in March or April? Do you know what the timeline is on that?
The last word from the Attorney General is that it's pending and they expect a decision in April.
Okay.
On what that warning should look like. But we fully anticipate additional litigation over the wording of that warning, even if it is adopted as it has been proposed, Your Honor. We think that warnings for acrylamide in food are misleading and controversial, that they are not purely factual, that they imply that this food will increase someone's risk of cancer. And there are now two decades of epidemiological studies showing that people who eat more acrylamide don't get cancer more often. And although it's not our burden to prove on that side of it, instead it's the Attorney General's burden to prove that the warning is purely factual and non-controversial. And we don't think they can meet that standard.
Counsel, and maybe you've already addressed this, but remind me, so the injunction is here. One of the claims is that the injunction is overbroad. It seems to have, if we get to the merits, it seems to be a bit problematic here that the district court enjoined all parties, including parties not before it. How can we uphold that? And is there some limiting principle we can use to distinguish this case from, say, Whole Women's Health versus Jackson or other cases?
Yes, Your Honor, it's a very good question because this is, Prop 65 is not SB 8. Under Prop 65, a private enforcer gains the power to sue only by filing and serving a 60-day notice along with a certificate that they've consulted with experts and that they believe the case has merit. And only after the 60 days passes and no public official has sued can the private enforcer go forward. So at any given moment in time, we know who these private enforcers are. Cal Chamber has given notice to every single one of them and does so as they change over time. We give them notice. So there's no due process concern. They are aware of this litigation underway. They're aware of the preliminary injunction. The Attorney General's website posts a notice about the preliminary injunction as well. And the number of people there is certainly not the whole world. It's 12. 12 individuals or corporations have pending 60-day notices on Prop 65 under a
But it could also include somebody who's thinking about filing one, right?
Well, they could. They're not barred from serving a new 60-day notice, Your Honor. So they can absolutely.
Well, but they would be barred from. I mean, they'd still be barred from after 60 days pursuing the litigation.
They would be so long as the preliminary injunction is in place and so long as before the case is decided. But there would be reasons why they would serve the notice. The notice will toll the statute of limitations because the claimant will be under a disability under California Civil Procedure Code Section 356. They will claim their turf, if you will, as against other private enforcers be there first. And they will be on notice with the public elected officials as well. So there are reasons why they would do that. There's no infringement on their ability to do that.
So, but counsel, and maybe I'm missing the practical way that they would be able to vindicate their rights. So let's assume we have some putative enforcer out there. Would the only way that they would theoretically be able to have their voice heard on whether they should have the right to file a lawsuit would be to a way which they could then appeal if they lost would be to intervene and then ask that the extant injunction be modified, and assuming they didn't have any procedural problem with waiting too long or something like that, then appeal if the district court denied it. But would they have to start with a motion to intervene?
Well, Your Honor, I don't think they would have to. They would have to intervene, obviously, in order to be heard in federal court. But they could be heard as amici as well. But their interests are fully represented by the Attorney General, who's defending.
Well, I hear that, but as I hear what you're saying on that, but as I understand the way injunctions normally work, if they are applicable, if an injunction were applicable to this putative party and they went ahead and filed a lawsuit anyway, you could go to court and ask that they be held in contempt for violating this injunction, and the only opportunity they would have to deal with that would be in that kind of contempt proceeding?
That could be, Your Honor. I think it's unlikely because it seems that a state court would honor the federal district court's ruling here and perhaps not proceed, perhaps dismiss the case, perhaps stay the case pending the final judgment that we expect from the Eastern District. And so I think it's quite speculative to think that Cal Chamber would need to bring somebody in on a contempt charge.
Well, then, and that's because everyone would follow the order, even though other than intervention, they wouldn't have had the right to have their voice heard or theoretically through filing an amicus brief before the district court.
Well, the Superior Court would not be bound by the district court's ruling here, but the Superior Court might look at it and say, as many have already, given the pendency of the Cal Chamber lawsuit, many Superior Courts have looked at it and said, there's a real issue here as to the First Amendment rights of the defendants in these cases. We're going to hold off on moving forward in these lawsuits while this issue is still pending.
Obviously, I mean, this is, I guess, sort of a rhetorical question, but your clients obviously could have sued and tried to enjoin whoever you wanted. And if there are only 12 actors out there or 15 or 20, you could have sued all 12 or 15 or 20 and given them specific notice and opportunity to be heard, and you chose not to.
Your Honor, and I think the prior case showed one of the reasons why. Because we would run into Norr Pennington, we would run into the California anti-SLAPP statute. And my client does not want to litigate these side issues. We'd like to litigate the core issue in these cases. And we would like preliminary relief. That's what we asked the district court for, and what the district court saw, how absurd it would be for the attorney general to not be able to sue, and yet private enforcers could, and saw the harm that was befalling the food industry with hundreds of lawsuits over acrylamide in food that are not substantiated and that indeed are infringing their First Amendment rights by forcing a compelled false and misleading warning. And so that's the harm. And in her exercise of her equitable powers and application of Rule 65 and the Winter factors, the court balanced the harms and came to the conclusion that this sort of injunction would prevent those harms from continuing throughout the pendency of the lawsuit, which is a temporary period of time. And the court was well within its power to do so. As a result, we ask that you affirm, and I see I'm way over my time, unless the court has further questions.
Well, we took you over your time. There are questions, so don't worry about that. And we're giving Mr. Metzger some extra time, but unless one of my colleagues has a question, I have none. Questions? I don't hear any questions. Therefore, we thank Mr. Norris for his advocacy, and we'll hear from Mr. Metzger again.
Thank you very much, Judge Gould. I have 2 minutes. Is there any particular issue that Mr. Norris has raised that any of you judges would like me to address? Otherwise, I'll speak for 2 minutes.
Well, you know, Mr. Metzger, I feel bad that I took so much of your time on standing, and I will ask Judge Gould, perhaps if you need it, to give you more time, but I would like to hear your focused presentation, even if it takes more than 2 minutes. And again, I'll ask Judge Gould to give you more time on the merits.
Okay, yes.
On the compelled speech issue, the district court didn't abuse its discretion.
Thank you, Your Honor. I really appreciate that.
We'll add 2 minutes to the clock.
Thank you, Judge Gould. So I think it's important to actually look at the evidence that we submitted in opposition to the motion for preliminary injunction, because Judge Mueller did not. And she made certain factual findings. And those findings that she made were really just not based on evidence, they were assumptions. And I pointed out in our brief where in the record, we had senior scientists from federal agencies and our other experts who opined at the Cert versus Starbucks trial of this false compelled speech claim, where her so-called findings or assumptions are contradicted by the expert testimony, which she never read. I think that's really important, because if a judge is going to issue a preliminary injunction and joining the exercise of First Amendment rights against a party who's already prevailed on the very claim before her, at the very least, she should look at the evidence that was presented before her and not make findings that are contrary to it. She never looked at it. And she said at the hearing, I don't see any reason to look at it. She just had a different view of the case, totally disregarded what the state court judge did, totally disregarded all the evidence from the that we submitted during a 3-month trial, and just came up with her own thoughts and issued a preliminary injunction and joining my client's First Amendment rights. The last point that I would make is that my client's rights are not being represented by the Attorney General. We are in litigation with the Attorney General and the state of California, because the administrative agency that handles these issues, which is called the Office of Environmental Health Hazard Assessment, they are operating under directives from the governor's office to basically end acrylamide and food litigation because it's politically a hot potato. They don't like it. So the Attorney General does not represent in any way the interests of the private enforcers, and we've sued them regarding that. And in addition, the Attorney General does not have First Amendment rights of petition and speech as the private enforcers do. Those are rights to individuals, not to government. So the Attorney General does not represent the interests adequately. CERT has been representing the interests adequately, especially because the Attorney General refuses to do so and refused to even file an appeal, even though the Attorney General has now been enjoined by the district court from carrying out his primary duty of enforcing California law. So that's another reason why I think this court should have considered that CERT has standing, especially because the Attorney General has failed to do his job. CERT is the one that's enforcing California law in this case, not the Attorney General. And I get rather passionate about that, so excuse my fervor, if you would. I really do believe that the issuance of a preliminary injunction enjoining an NGO from attempting to file lawsuits that are whose intent is to protect public health is impermissible under the First Amendment as a prior restraint on the exercise of both speech and petition rights. And for that reason, I would ask the court to adopt the ruling of the motions panel, which found that CERT was likely to prevail on the merits of the pure constitutional issue, and that this court reversed the preliminary injunction on that ground, or alternatively on the ground that the district court abused her discretion in issuing the preliminary injunction because she failed and refused to consider the scientific evidence, which was evidence that satisfied a state court judge following a 3-month trial that there was no constitutional violation of defendants' rights to against force compelled speech. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Metzger. This is a challenging case. Again, we appreciate the excellent advocacy, Mr. Metzger and Mr. Norris, on both sides of the case. Unless there are questions from one of my colleagues, we will now submit this case and the parties will hear from us in due course. Hearing no question, the clerk should note this case submitted and the court will proceed to a 10 minute recess before we take up the remaining cases on the docket.
Hello. This court stands in recess for 10 minutes. Okay.